The Guardian newspaper is one of the key parts of the British liberal establishment. Generally speaking, its coverage of UK and world events reflects a set of opinions and attitudes which champion liberal, humanistic, and left rather than right-wing values. In the past, in its coverage of, for example, South and Latin America, it reported on and supported those movements opposed to American imperialism and the dictators who they backed with money and arms. In UK domestic policies, it does not join the chorus of those who are attacking the poor and powerless. It supports progressive social policies, and it is firmly internationalist in its outlook, having no time for the resurgence of petty nationalism characterized by parties such as the United Kingdom Independence Party. But for many years, the predominant public narrative has been that the paper was losing money on a spectacular scale, was grossly overstaffed, and had foolishly set its face against charging for online content, and therefore was doomed. Its disappearance would indeed be a massive blow, as it is almost a lone voice of liberal values in the UK media. And it has in fact seen its circulation figures collapse in the last 6 years, from over 300,000 a day to well under 200,000. And as it is not owned by a rich proprietor, to whom can it turn to survive? Well, in the last few months, barely remarked on by the British media, the evidence has started to emerge that this narrative should be changed. The Guardian is not likely to go out of business. Indeed, it could become the world's leading liberal online media presence. But for this reason, now is also the time to ask hard questions about its journalism. Now that the spectre of extinction is not there, should it be doing better? The Guardian, then called the Manchester Guardian, started life in the 1920s as a weekly paper, in its words, in the liberal interest. Although the meaning and interpretation of this has obviously changed over time, it has shaped and steered the general attitude and politics of the paper. As always, history and culture is important. So it is not a socialist paper. It is not a paper of the labour movement. But as mainstream British politics has moved to the right, it has been possible for The Guardian to be seen more as a beacon of a set of values that lie on the liberal left of the political spectrum. The second part of The Guardian's history, which is critical to understanding its position today, is its ownership. At the beginning of the 20th century, The Guardian was taken over by its then editor, C.P. Scott. It was his ambition to run and edit an independent paper, but not for private gain. At the time, this was an extraordinary idea, only marginally less extraordinary than today. Scott remained editor for most of his life, but when he and his son died in quick succession in the 1930s, the idea of the independent, not-for-profit newspaper was threatened. Fortunately, within a few years, the remaining members of the Scott family had established the Scott Trust to own the paper. The Scott Trust had no shareholders, and so all of the profits of the paper could be ploughed into keeping it in business. And at the time, this was not the hardest thing to do. Newspapers were widely read, there was plenty of advertising, and very little competition from radio and television. The paper expanded its news, moved to London, and bought up other newspapers. One of these purchases, it turns out, was an inspired business decision. In 1982, The Guardian bought a magazine which specialised in selling cars, Auto Trader. Its rough and ready appearance and its editorial content seemed to have nothing to do with The Guardian. But today it has proved to be its saviour, and it is why The Guardian's future is secure. In recent years, The Guardian has been hit in the same way as other newspapers, declining readership and declining advertising income, as readers give up on printed newspapers and find what they want for free online, and advertisers find better ways of reaching consumers. As a result, The Guardian has announced massive losses year after year. If you go to the Guardian Media Group website and go to the section on financials, you can, from 2008 onwards, click through to their annual report, a glossy affair showing the achievements of the paper and setting out the ambitious plans for the future, but also containing the financial results. Operating losses in 2008, in 2009, in 2010. Grim reading, and powerful ammunition for the rest of the media who wanted to portray The Guardian as a hopeless lame duck. And an idea which The Guardian themselves seemed willing to promote. In 2011, it announced its digital-first strategy, in which it aimed to massively increase its online income. The Guardian had launched its first website in 1996, and in 2011, it also launched Guardian US. But at the same time, the then chief executive warned that the parent company, Guardian Media Group, could run out of cash in 3 to 5 years if the business operations did not change, and that the newspapers would aim to save 25 million over the next 5 years, releasing funds to be reinvested in other activities. Behind the threats of running out of cash and the operating losses lay the crock of gold, the investment in Auto Trader, an investment which last year was finally sold, and the transforming impact on The Guardian became clear. Media coverage of The Guardian's finances appears to be heavily influenced by the hopes and the dreams of their competitors. So, at the beginning of July, The Telegraph reported, "Heavy investment in the United States by the publisher of The Guardian is failing to pay off, it can be disclosed, as the company prepares to report another multi-million pound loss next week. Guardian News and Media has spent 6 years and tens of millions of pounds attempting to break into the American media market. In the last 3 years, it has hired dozens of journalists in New York to fill a website that aims to become a major source of free-to-access news for left-leaning Americans. The strategy, driven from London by Alan Rusbridger, the editor of The Guardian, has reaped some rewards in the form of web traffic, but commercial success has been elusive." You get the drift. All the fault of the editor of the lefty competitor to The Telegraph. The same Telegraph piece does go on to report that The Guardian had received £619 million from the sale of Auto Trader, but the tone was generally downbeat, and no one in the media seems to have looked at the figures in detail, which you can by clicking on The Guardian website. And this is what it shows. The Guardian lost just under £40 million last year, but at the end of the year, it had over £840 million of cash and investments. We can assume that The Guardian has some of the best investment advice in the business. So this year, the income from their investments, if conservatively invested, will probably wipe out that loss. And the much criticized digital strategy looks as though it is working. The Guardian is now the third most read online paper in the world. Only the Daily Mail, which could not remotely be considered a competitor, and the New York Times is ahead of it. And, as the Telegraph said, The Guardian is only just starting in the US of A. Last year, The Guardian's digital income rose by nearly 25%, and it is now a third of total income. And at £70 million in 2014, the forecast of £90 million for 2016 may not be quite as fanciful as the pundits thought when they scoffed 3 years ago. The Guardian has almost certainly achieved what its editor, Alan Rusbridger, has described as sustainable losses. Indeed, if the new American and Australian online versions succeed, it is possible the losses will fall, making the whole business even more sustainable. So The Guardian is probably out of the woods, if it was ever in them. But the problem is that during the years of struggle, survival, and eventual success, it has changed the way it does the journalism, so that now original, Guardian-sourced investigation and inquiry is not at the centre of what it does. Like every media organisation, it struggles with the demands of 24-hour news, in which there is little time to research a story, and so journalists rely on the news fed to them by the increasing flotilla of public relations people. On one estimate, there are at least 4 PR people for every journalist in the country. And these people churn out an unending supply of press releases for journalists to use to fill their pages. Studies have shown that sometimes as much as 75% of what you read in a newspaper comes from a press release. In other words, the amount of original journalism is quite small. And The Guardian has not escaped this trend. In recent years, the investigation for which the paper is probably best known, and rightly so, is its determined commitment to reveal the scandal of phone hacking at the News of the World newspaper. In a series of articles over several months, The Guardian reporter Nick Davis revealed that the hacking of the phones of politicians, celebrities, and other members of the public was widespread, systemic, and in some cases approved at the highest level in the News of the World. And there had been a cover-up of this. There were widespread repercussions of this investigation, including the closure of the News of the World and the conviction of its former editor, who had later become the press secretary to the UK's Prime Minister. One of the distinguishing features of this investigation was the determination of The Guardian's reporter, Nick Davis, supported by the paper's editor, not to give up in the face of attacks from the News of the World and others who denied the allegations. One of the other features of the investigation is that it was an original piece of work. This is noteworthy because one of the characteristics of The Guardian's journalism, which has been developed in recent years, has been to rely on other outside organisations for its revelations. For example, in 2010, The Guardian was the British newspaper which published the WikiLeaks papers. Other newspapers around the world did so simultaneously. There is no doubt that a great public service was provided by the publication of these papers. A unique and chilling insight was given into the secret diplomacy of the United States and to some of the realities of the wars in Iraq and Afghanistan. There is also no doubt that The Guardian put a lot of its resources into analysing the documents and publishing the stories around them. But they were leaked documents. Teams of Guardian journalists were not engaged in going out into the world to discover the story. Or take the example of the Snowden files. Last year, using files leaked to it by Edward Snowden, the former contract employee of the National Security Agency, The Guardian revealed that the NSA had monitored millions of phone calls and emails, including those of allied governments. And it also revealed that the communications of those attending the G10 summit in London had been intercepted by the UK's government communications headquarters, GCHQ. Again, a major public service was served by publishing this, and, as in the case of the phone hacking story, the paper stood firm in the face of criticism. But again, it was a story based on leaked documents. Or take the story published in April last year about the secret offshore bank accounts of the world's wealthy. As its opening paragraph said, millions of internal records have leaked from Britain's offshore financial industry, exposing for the first time the identities of thousands of holders of anonymous wealth from around the world, from presidents to plutocrats, the daughter of a notorious dictator, and a British millionaire accused of concealing assets from his ex-wife. Millions of internal records have leaked. All of these projects were in a great tradition of public service journalism, and all were ones to which The Guardian devoted its own resources, not least of which was the legal advice and security which a big organisation can provide. All were, in fact, the sort of story which only an organisation like The Guardian can do. But for every thousand or tens of thousands of pounds spent on this sort of story cannot be spent elsewhere. And whilst The Guardian and its sister paper, The Observer, are full of columnists who provide sharp commentary on the failings of the British state, politicians and their policies, the newspaper's news and features pages are not full of original investigative work, which reveals what's going on in business, politics and society. If, as seems likely, The Guardian is moving towards both a financially sustainable future and becoming the world's leading left-leaning liberal media outlet, then now may be the time to turn part of its considerable resource to long-term investigations of its own.